Good morning. Interactive audience, I love it. How many of you came here by subway this morning? Wow, that's almost all of you. I bet the scene on the train looked something like this. Bit dirtier maybe, a bit busier, it's New York City, but you get the point. So it took ChatGPT just a couple seconds to generate this image. And I used the prompt of commuters on a New York City subway train. While I did not include it in my prompt, you can see if you look carefully that except for the guy with the newspaper and the guy standing next to the post, everybody is interacting with their phones, right? Familiar picture. And this is, of course, because they make life easier for us. We can solve problems in a fraction of the time that it would normally take us, like figuring out directions to this theater. So interacting with these devices feels natural, more and more natural, doesn't it? It may seem as if us, you know, living, breathing organisms, are increasingly connected to these devices, as if they're becoming integrated with us, as if these devices are becoming a physical extension of us. Now, in reality, this is very far from the truth, because biology and our technological devices are actually built very, very differently. And they have complementary strengths. Tech, the ultra-fast problem solver, and biology and life, the creative innovator and builder. I believe that when you put the two of them together, there exists an opportunity to create some of the most exciting and sustainable technology imaginable. I'm a scientist in the field of bio-inspired nanotechnology, and in the next few minutes, I'd like to talk to you about our unique moment in time where we can start to combine the complementary strengths of artificial intelligence and automation with biology to create a future that truly combines the best of both worlds. So I mentioned that biology is this amazing innovator, and it, of course, does that through a process of evolution. It's a very slow process. It took us billions of years to get where we are today. But during that process, there's been some incredible innovation. Perhaps one of the best examples would be the human brain. And you've probably heard this before, the human brain is also the most powerful computer known today. And what's more, it only uses a fraction of the energy consumption compared to your device. And it doesn't create any e-waste, right? Natural materials are degradable and recyclable. So this begs a question: why can't we make everything, computers and everything else, using biology's designs? Now, the problem is that this is so complex, involving so many different variables, that building anything resembling the functionality of a living system from scratch is currently completely out of the picture. In fact, figuring out how life works, the level of the fundamental building blocks, is probably the world's most complex problem. But this is exactly where artificial intelligence and AI and automation can come in. And we've known this for decades, that computers are amazing at this. Think about when computers started to beat humans at board games like chess, and more recently, the ancient game Go. In order for the computer to learn the rules and improve, it basically needs access to a lot of data. And this data is available through the millions of hours of human versus machine sequences of moves that then the machine can learn on and generate patterns from. And as these patterns are recognized, they can then basically find solutions that are beyond what a human would be able to come up with. So the computer is literally starting to beat us at our own game. So these observations about the complexity of biology and the incredible problem-solving powers of AI lead us to some questions. can we use the problem-solving powers of AI to figure out how biology works at the fundamental level? And if we learn how biology builds, we can learn how to build like biology. And that would have some consequences. So this is what I want to talk about. So let me start with some differences between life and tech. So what are the fundamental units of life? So this is something that scientists love to disagree about, but most of us would agree that they are single cells. So single cells are very small, invisible to the human eye, but they are remarkably sophisticated. In fact, they can learn new functions. So for example, when a stem cell receives the right messages, it can become a nerve cell and basically learn how to communicate with other cells. And these communications can become huge, can involve huge numbers of cells. Like in the brain, we have about 100 billion of them, making trillions of connections. And this network of cells and their connections basically allows us to remember what we had for dinner last night or plan what we want to do next weekend. And in fact, it allows us to deal with situations that look nothing like anything we've ever perceived before. So to plan and to create and to innovate. So we refer to these complex networks, as you might expect, as complex adaptive systems. And complex adaptive systems are really fundamental to how life operates. So, and they're actually, the essence of them is actually more intuitive than you might expect. So we're in a university environment today, right? So imagine a class, but this is not just an ordinary class, it's a class full of students who have complementary and different backgrounds. So there may be, you know, a chemist, a historian, a physicist, an engineer, a philosopher, all in the same class. They're asked to design a house. Now, guess what happens when all these students individually get to work on this house versus when these students start to exchange ideas and collaborate, right? You guessed it. You get two things really happening. The product of this collaboration will be a more impressive house. A home of the future that has new features that we've never thought of before. Well, and in addition, the process means that every student who's involved in this process actually generates more knowledge. And the group as a whole generates more knowledge too. So it's a clear situation of 1 + 1 being way more than 3. And this is exactly how life works at many levels. The level of the organism, these students, the level of the cells, as I've showed you previously, and I will show you in a moment how this also works at the level of the molecules. So it's an incredible concept of, you know, bringing things together and basically achieving way bigger goals through the process of collaboration. So I've talked a little bit about life, so let me switch to tech. Okay, so what cells are to life, semiconductor chips are to technology. So these things are also small. They can fit on your fingertip. In your iPhone, you have about 25 of them, all serving different purposes. And if you look at them carefully, they're actually very complicated networks of billions of little switches. And those actually create the zeros and ones. So these integrated circuits, just like cells, they're incredibly complex, but unlike cells, they are completely static. Okay, so life is this dynamic, chaotic thing, but these things are completely static. And that exactly allows them to do the same thing over and over again. Calculations very, very accurately and very, very precisely. And unlike humans, there is less room for creativity or, as you witnessed earlier, an occasional defect in the thinking process. So these things are close to perfect, doing the same thing over and over again. Guess how these things are made? I don't know if you've ever thought about this, but it's quite an incredible process. So I was lucky enough to, with some colleagues and students from the City University of New York, visit one of the world's most advanced chip manufacturing plants right here in New York State. So we all got gowned up, as you can see in the picture, and this is actually to protect that environment against us biological invaders. So when you step inside this environment, it's vast. It's completely vast, and it's completely mind-blowing. You don't see hardly any humans at work. It's just robots zipping around very quickly, dropping off components, picking them up, as these chips are assembled with incredible precision. And huge numbers of them are created in that environment. So having talked about life and cells and tech and chips, as I mentioned, I'm excited about the idea of bringing them together. So how can we get them to talk to each other? So what is their language or code? So of course, the code of tech is very familiar. Strings of zeros and ones, right? So the one on the screen shows the sequence for the word apple. But it can be many other things. This code is very versatile. It doesn't really matter if you're looking at a picture or a movie or a piece of text. And biology has a similar level of code, DNA, super familiar to, I'm sure, everybody. Four letters that are themselves an abstract code. But biology has another level. And this is where the molecular magic of life really comes into focus. So the 20 amino acids that build all proteins. Because in this code, each digit is no longer meaningless. It is actually part of an assembly instruction. So it is essentially a building code. So what that means is if you put a whole string of these together, they by themselves basically create the structure. So the code is the structure. It's as if the word apple no longer represents the fruit, but actually looks like it, tastes like it, smells like an apple. Or to put it in a different way, I don't know if anyone of you has recently had the pleasure or displeasure to go to IKEA and purchase some self-assembly furniture. It's as if that doesn't need an instruction manual. That's the idea. So you basically come home, empty the box on the floor, and spontaneously it assembles into your new chair. Wouldn't that be nice? So this code then creates all the proteins in our bodies, and there's a very large number of them, hundreds of thousands in each cell, and they, again, are a complex adaptive system working together to achieve bigger goals. And those are then the cells. And the cells then work together as a complex adaptive system to create the organs and the organisms. So life is really like a Russian doll of complex adaptive systems, from the molecular to the cellular to the macroscopic scale. But it starts with this code. It starts with this assembly code and this building code. So wouldn't it be amazing if you could decipher that code? And you guessed it. Scientists have, of course, taken to AI to try to solve this problem and figure out how millions of these proteins fold into specific shapes. And they were able to do that because there was a fantastic database available that was painstakingly put together over a period of about 60 years where a lot of these proteins were solved and the structure shared, and then computer algorithms can basically train on them to figure out ultimately how proteins fold. Now, you can take a new sequence and put it in this software, and within no time, you'll have an idea about its structure. And because we now have a blueprint, it means we can start doing things that are not things that evolution ever needed. So thinking about completely new proteins, or completely new systems. And in my laboratory here at the City University of New York, we actually try to use this idea as really a completely universal building code. Biology is amazing, but there's so many other things we can build from this. So we look at things like biodegradable, surfactants and gelators that may be useful for the cosmetics industry. And we look at technological applications like biodegradable electronics and coatings, and also energy materials that morph and store and harvest energy. And this is exciting because it shows that we can now start to build with biomolecules. But it's actually only scratching the surface because we're not yet at the level where we're actually fully taking advantage of this idea of a complex adaptive system. And that really is a leap because scientists are very used to studying molecules in isolation, but this idea of a mixture of molecules collaborating where then the functionality comes from all these molecules working together is really an altogether different game. In fact, this is an area of chemistry that is now developing separately and has its own name. It's called systems chemistry. And in my lab, we use systems chemistry to try to actually get molecules to do things that you would normally not expect. So inside test tubes, we try to demonstrate things like learning and memory. And can mixtures of molecules actually learn how to do new things? And that generates these rewritable assembly patterns that you're looking at on the screen. This is a lot of work. Some of my students and postdocs are in the audience today. You can talk to them after. This can take years to complete. But now we're excited because there is now automation and AI to massively speed up these processes and get us to innovate much, much faster. So where does this lead us? We have a desire to automate, and you think back to the chip manufacturing facility that I showed you, where everything is automated. So the dream is really to have an equivalent version that automates biomolecular self-assembly. And it doesn't have to be this kind of AI-generated dream that you're looking at on the screen. Actually, these automated and robotic labs already exist, and more are being built, including right here in New York City, ready to help us innovate. If we learn how to build like biology, the opportunities are really endless. It may start with something like your drinks bottle made out of biomolecules, and it's programmed to respond to its context. So you finish your drink, expose it to some salty seawater, and it spontaneously disintegrates. And ultimately, it can lead to organic, adaptive computer architectures that are inspired by how the human brain works. There's a lot to do, and it really is like a moonshot. But if we put our minds to it, there can be a future where life and tech are no longer separate, but increasingly integrated. And if we really combine the strengths of those two, there is an opportunity to create bio-inspired technology that is much more in sync with our planet. This may even lead to a new industrial revolution. Right now, biological systems are still far superior compared to pretty much any human-made technology. But we live in this unique time where we can start to really take advantage of all the growth in AI and automation and robotics so that we eventually essentially close the loop, so that ultimately everything, including tech itself, can be made from biomolecules. And we're very excited to make this happen right here in New York City. Thank you very much.